Good morning. The first item of business is general questions, and at question number one, I call Paul O'Kane.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on its target to recruit 800 additional GPs by the end of 2027.
Cabinet Secretary Humza Yousaf.
We are making good progress, and since 2017, GP headcount has increased by almost 300, 291, and a record 5,209 GPs are working in Scotland. We've increased medical undergraduate intake as well by 448 places since 2015-16, and we'll also be increasing GP speciality training by 100 places over the next 3 years. Fill rates for speciality training is also at a record high, with a 99% fill rate for 2022. Last year, I launched our GP recruitment marketing campaign, and we're providing significant investment in initiatives which ensure that being a GP remains an attractive career option.
Paul O'Kane.
Yeah, I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his answer. We know that Audit Scotland has found that the Scottish Government will fail to meet their own target for increased GP numbers, which is indicative of their failure in workforce planning over many years. But it's not just the recruitment issue. There's also a significant issue with capacity in GP surgeries. Surgeries are busting at the seams, with the BMA finding that 81% of practices are currently exceeding capacity. In the village of Neilston, which I represent, I spoke with GP partners of the Neilston Medical Centre, who told me they are struggling to find the physical space to meet demand. They applied to the Scottish Government for loans to increase space, but the application was rejected. Indeed, if the practice can't expand, they may be forced to close their books. So I would ask the Cabinet Secretary why GP surgeries are not being given the support they need by this Government to extend provision of general practice in their communities.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, they are being given support. That's why we've increased GP numbers by 291. That's why we've increased multidisciplinary team numbers by 3,220. It's not just about, of course, having GPs. That's very important, hence why we're increasing the numbers. It's about having that multidisciplinary team right across GP surgeries in Scotland. We do have a loan scheme, which Paul O'Kane has mentioned. Of course, if there's a particular issue that he has, I'm more than happy for him to write to me. But we are providing support for our general practices and for our general practitioners.
Sandesh Gulhani.
The reality is that the Scottish Government is nowhere near meeting its target to recruit 800 additional GPs. Yet another example of promises but no delivery, with £65 million cut from the primary care budget. This week we heard from the BMA that 4 in 10 doctors are actively looking to leave and are looking at balloting to strike. A surgeon in Lothian said 1 in 4 operations for children with life-saving surgeries being cancelled at short notice due to a chronic shortage of critical care nurses, and they're not included in figures. Does the Health Secretary seriously expect us to believe the situation is improving? What steps will the Cabinet Secretary take to address these catastrophic failures?
Cabinet Secretary.
He says, does he really believe us to expect the position isn't improving? I mean, the fact is that we have 291 more GPs than we had in 2017. Headcount has increased. We have a record 5,209 GPs. We have 3,220 multidisciplinary staff, many of them working right across general practice up and down the country. So we'll continue to support general practice. I've mentioned, of course, that we're increasing our medical graduate intake as well. On top of that, we have a 99%, a record high fill rate when it comes to speciality training too. So I'll continue to work with the British Medical Association, I'll continue to work with the Royal College of GPs, but this government has an excellent record in supporting our general practice. Not only that, an excellent record in helping and assisting our general practice, particularly in rural Scotland, where we know there's some challenges, and the ScotGem programme is just one example of that.
Short questions and responses help me get more members in. Willie Rennie.
I don't think that's what Kate Forbes says, but nevertheless, the Minister has a sunny disposition, but he is spinning a bogus argument. If you look at the Public Health Scotland estimates, whole-time equivalent GPs, not headcount, whole-time equivalent has fallen by 26.4 between 2017 and 2022. So he's making no progress. In fact, it's worse than when he started. Why is he not listening to the warnings?
Cabinet Secretary.
We are. That's why headcount numbers have increased by 291. And in terms of whole-time equivalence, it's a good thing, of course, that we are introducing flexible working. That helps with retention. So I've already outlined all of the key lines, all of the key measures that we are taking to support general practice. And I do not think Willie Rennie is in any position to lecture anybody on electoral success. He, of course, presided over disastrous election defeat after disastrous election defeat for his party. His party couldn't even field a five-a-side football team, for goodness sake.
Question number two, Pam Gossall.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to the recorded crime in Scotland statistics for the year ending December 2022.
Cabinet Secretary Keith Brown.
These figures show Scotland continues to be a safe place to live, with recorded crime at one of the lowest levels since 1974 and down 42% since 2006-07. This is a testimony to the continued efforts across policing, justice and community safety partners to deliver a safer Scotland for everyone. We recognise, of course, that challenges remain, which is why, for example, you've taken robust action to tackle sexual offending and have invested over £93 million over the past 5 years to ensure that victims' rights and needs are at the centre of Scotland's criminal justice system.
Pam Gossall.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for the response. At the end of last month, when these recorded crime statistics came out, the Cabinet Secretary boasted about how safe Scotland is. But I think domestic abuse victims will have different take on this, on these statistics. The data revealed that for the year ending December 2022, there were more crimes recorded under the Domestic Abuse Act than in any other year since its introduction. Instead of boasting about how safe Scotland is to victims of these heinous crimes, will the Cabinet Secretary work with me by backing my plans to tackle domestic abuse in Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, it's not a boast to acknowledge the efforts of policing, justice and community safety partners to say that Scotland is a safe place to live, and I don't know whether the member welcomes that or not, and that their efforts have contributed to a 42% reduction in recorded crime since this government came to office. That is a statement of fact. I don't know if the member's uncomfortable with that, but that is simply the case. And of course, in relation to domestic abuse, a great deal has been done to make sure that we increase the reporting of domestic abuse, and that's something to be welcomed. And as to the member's bill, I don't know how many times she's going to demand of me that I support her bill without seeing her bill, without even seeing as yet the analysis of the consultation on her bill. By all means, let's have a discussion which I happily have already entered into with a member, but at least let us see the evidence first before we come to a conclusion.
I call Audrey Nicholl.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I also welcome the continued decrease in recorded crime levels in Scotland, which remain at one of the lowest levels for any 12-month period since comparable records began. But we all agree there is much more to be done for those who experience crime. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary what steps are being taken to strengthen support for victims of crime?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the member rightly asked what steps we've taken, and we have established the Victim Centred Approach Fund, invested £48 million over 22 to 25. We've awarded over £917,000 from the Victim Surcharge Fund to provide practical help and support. And as announced yesterday, the forthcoming Criminal Justice Reform Bill will introduce new rights to independent legal representation in sexual offence cases, alongside providing anonymity for victims and abolishing the not proven verdict. The bill will also be informed by recent consultation on improving victims' experiences, including proposals for a victims commissioner. So I think that will indicate to the member the breadth of measures which we are taking in this area.
Question number three, David Torrance. Mr. Torrance.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what support it provides to a deaf community.
Minister Claire Hawhey.
The Scottish Government provides around £2.2 million in funding through the Equality and Human Rights Fund and the Children, Young People and Families Early Intervention Fund to third sector projects which work with deaf people. We also provide funding of £600,000 per year to Contact Scotland BSL, an online video relay service enabling deaf and deafblind BSL users to make phone calls. We also fund the Scottish Sensory Centre and Call Scotland to provide advice and training to school staff and support, including the use of assistive technology for children and young people with specific communication and sensory needs.
David Torrance.
I thank the Minister for her answer. I recently met with a local deaf club in my constituency to discuss the problems facing people whose first language is BSL. Can I ask the Minister what action the Scottish Government has taken to promote the provision of written information and correspondence from Scottish businesses and organisations such as OSCAR to BSL users in the format they can access, read and understand?
Minister.
So the Scottish Government is committed to promoting the use and understanding of British Sign Language, BSL, as a fully recognised language across the Scottish public sector. BSL users can contact businesses using the Contact Scotland BSL online video relay interpreting service, and businesses can contact their deaf customers in the same way. Contact Scotland BSL is widely promoted to the deaf BSL users and service providers through a series of free online webinars and visits to deaf clubs.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful, Presiding Officer. The Minister will be aware of the damning findings of the audit into NHS Lothian's audiology department and how this affects the deaf community. Last week, a number of local MSPs met with the families directly and heard how it's affecting them. So will the government confirm that they will meet with local MSPs and families from the Families Failed by Lothian Audiology Action Group to ensure that treatment, support and needs of these children can be met? And most importantly, we find out how many children have been affected.
Yeah. Minister.
I thank Mr Whitfield for his supplementary question. Of course, the responsibility for NHS audiology lies with my health colleagues, some of whom are in chamber today, and I'm sure they respond appropriately to Mr Whitfield.
Question number four, Michelle Thompson.
To ask the Scottish Government when the final report of the National Autism Implementation Team's adult neurodevelopmental pathway trials, which were conducted within four NHS board areas, will be available.
Minister Kevin Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Adult Neurodevelopment Pathways pilot ran for 12 months from January 2022, funded by £650,000 from the Scottish Government. The report will be published on the 16th of March and will be available on National Autism Implementation Team's website. A national learning event hosted by the National Autism Implementation Team is also planned for the 16th of March, and the Scottish Government will be considering the next steps.
Michelle Thompson.
I thank the Minister for that response. The ADHD Foundation state that undiagnosed and untreated ADHD in women and girls can have further impacts beyond health, including upon their education, employability and economic independence. Given this, does the Scottish Government have any data on the potential impact such a national pathway rollout could have for socially, economically disadvantaged women across health boards for the country, for whom the private assessment fees are simply unaffordable? Are there any plans to focus aspects of the rollout across all health boards to include such groups?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, we are aware that ADHD can have significant impacts. The ultimate aim of the pathway is that people can access the support that they need when they need it. And we'd be happy to think about socio-economic factors in taking all of this work forward.
Question number five, Stephanie Callaghan.
To ask the Scottish Government when it last engaged with NHS Lanarkshire.
Cabinet Secretary Humza Yousaf.
Both ministers and Scottish Government officials meet regularly with representatives of all health boards, including NHS Lanarkshire, and I last met with the leadership of NHS Lanarkshire last month to discuss plans for sustained improvement in local unscheduled care.
Stephanie Callaghan.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his response. The LMC, Lanarkshire Local Medical Committee, represents general practices across Lanarkshire, and they tell me they have significant concern around the vast increase in patients seeking fit notes from their GP, when the fit notes should have been issued by patients' hospital consultants at the time of treatment. Now, our consultants do an amazing job, but this issue needs to be ironed out. And the LMC tell me that thousands of unnecessary GP appointments are taken up by these patients each year as a consequence. And my constituency office
can
is aware
of similar have a question,
cases
Ms. Callaghan?
For patients referred for Glasgow Hospital, so it's a wider issue than that. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary what steps can be taken to ensure hospital consultants are issuing fit notes to patients to reduce the unnecessary
Thank
pressure
you, Ms.
on
Callaghan.
GPs?
Cabinet Secretary?
Well, I'm not aware of the issue being raised directly by the Lanarkshire Local Medical Committee with the government, but she's right, it is an issue that affects health services and general practice right across the country. So I will work closely with the BMA, with Royal College of GPs, with the health boards to see what we can do, because we know our general practice colleagues right up and down the country are under enormous pressure. It's why this government has a record of increasing the headcount number of GPs by 291, and we aim to go much further.
Question number six, Joe Fitzpatrick.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is regarding the potential impact on Scotland to the Windsor framework.
Cabinet Secretary Angus Robertson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government welcomes the Windsor Framework Agreement. The dispute over the Northern Ireland Protocol was of the UK Government's own making and was deeply damaging, threatening what would have been a catastrophic trade war with the European Union in the middle of a cost of living crisis. The Scottish Government also fully supports the Good Friday Agreement. However, Scotland, by the Prime Minister's own admission, is now at a major competitive disadvantage. Mr Sunak said that Northern Ireland was in an, and I quote, unbelievably special position and a unique position in the entire world.
Joe Fitzpatrick.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for his response. Has the Cabinet Secretary detected any substantial difference between the position of the UK Government and the Labour Party on Brexit? And given, as he said, the Scotland and the UK are no longer in the unbelievably special position that the Prime Minister has outlined for Northern Ireland, can the Scottish Government assess the impact on Scotland of being placed outside the EU single market and customs union, which is the policy of both the Tories and the Labour Party?
Cabinet Secretary.
Scotland is feeling the full damage of the UK Government's hard Brexit, despite our overwhelming vote to remain, and despite the fact that the Scottish Government put forward a compromise plan in 2016 to keep both the United Kingdom and Scotland in the single market, a compromise which was dismissed by UK ministers.
Let's hear the Cabinet Secretary.
We are reading the legal text of the Windsor Agreement and requesting more detail from the UK Government so we can establish in more detail what the framework will mean for Scotland. There appears to be no significant difference between the Conservative Party and the Labour Party on this. They both support a hard Brexit, which is hugely damaging. It's never been clearer that the only way to regain the benefits of European Union membership is for Scotland to be an independent country.
Question number 7, Emma Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it has taken with lambing season starting to support farmers to keep livestock safe, including in relation to promoting responsible countryside access.
Cabinet Secretary Mary Gujol.
The Dogs Protection of Livestock Amendment Scotland Act 2021 has been in force for over a year, and it provides Police Scotland and the courts with greater powers to deal with those who allow their dogs to worry, attack or kill livestock in Scotland's countryside. Increasing awareness is a key factor in the prevention of livestock worrying incidents and the associated unnecessary suffering. The Scottish Outdoor Access Code is clear on the rights and responsibilities of land managers and those exercising access rights and is widely publicised. And more generally, the Scottish Government delivered an awareness-raising digital campaign that ran in early 2021 and was rerun during 2021 and 2022 in partnership with the Scottish Society for the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals to promote that responsible dog ownership.
Emma Harper.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response. As well as the high costs on farmers due to the cost of living crisis and Brexit, farmers are still being financially and emotionally impacted due to attacks on their livestock by out-of-control dogs. And as lambing season begins, will the Cabinet Secretary again just reaffirm and join me in encouraging all when enjoying Scotland's beautiful countryside to do it responsibly and follow the Scottish Outdoor Access Codes and keep dogs under close control to prevent livestock from coming to harm?
Cabinet Secretary.
I just want to thank Emma Harper for raising these important matters in the Chamber today, because I don't think we can really emphasise enough just the impact that this has on our farmers, as the Member talked about, both financially and importantly emotionally as well. So I really would just encourage everyone who wants to enjoy our beautiful countryside to follow the Scottish Outdoor Access Code and to keep their dogs under close control to prevent livestock from coming to harm. The National Access Forum, which includes Nature Scot, the NFU, Police Scotland, the Scottish Kennel Club and Scottish Land and Estates, agreed that common high-level messaging for dog owners in 2020. And I know that Nature Scot will employ that messaging widely in the coming spring lambing season and throughout the rest of this year on their social media platforms as a key part of the ongoing Access Code campaign activity.
Question number 8, Christine Graham.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government what its position is on introducing legislation in Scotland similar to the UK Animals Low Welfare Activities Abroad Bill.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government takes animal welfare very seriously and remains committed to ensuring the highest standards in Scotland. And I would like to thank Christine Graham for raising this issue with me. And I know that we've corresponded on this recently, and where I did share my disappointment and my really extreme disappointment that this bill has been handled so poorly by the UK Government, which has ultimately left us with insufficient time to properly consider this important matter. I remain absolutely committed to improving animal welfare, and of course I'm open to considering similar proposals to restrict advertising in Scotland of unacceptable animal experiences abroad in future. However, this has to be done in a manner that respects the role of the Scottish Parliament and the other important animal welfare issues the Scottish Government wants to take forward.
Christine Graham.
Thank you very much, and I thank the Cabinet Secretary for a reply. That legislation of course refers to the use of animals such as Asian elephants for the entertainment of tourists in particular. The Cabinet Secretary referenced her letter to me, so can I ask her if she would meet with me and the Chief Executive of Save the Asian Elephants to see what measures this Scottish Government can take to help end exploitation of these magnificent beasts?
Briefly, Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, just to say that we are really happy to, of course, have those discussions. The Government has already reached out to stakeholders, and my officials have met with Mr McNair and Mr Stevenson as recently as Monday of this week to discuss the bill. And as a result of that constructive engagement, I just want to thank them and to thank Save the Asian Elephants for their kind offer of assistance as we look to explore ways that we can improve the welfare of not just elephants, but all animals that are subject to low welfare conditions.
Thank you. That concludes general questions. The next item of business is First Minister's questions.